Right, it's now time for Checkpoint, and as you would imagine, we would be discussing the matter of ODM elections, or the elections that never were. And of course, we'll not just be taking a look at what's happening in ODM, but also what's happening within the National Alliance Party, which is the ruling party in the country today. And hopefully we'll have some revelations today on the show, as I'm briefed people will be shifting parties today. Let's see if that will happen. But let me introduce you to my panel. Gunjiri Wambugu, who's a member of ODM, newspaper columnist. Thank you for joining us. Johnson Sakaja, regular here on Checkpoint. He's the chair of the TNA. And Judith Pariano joins our panel tonight, the chair of the National Elections Board within the Orange Democratic Movement. Many thanks, John Buddy, MP, Suba. Ladies first, Judith, tell us about this. The preparations were made to understand were all in place, and then we heard from Isaac Maura, and then we had issues of possible campaigning, during or just before the polls. Tell us, in your estimation, what went wrong on Friday?
Yes, thank you so much. I want to say that we did our best as a board and also as a party. We did prepare for elections. We set a date. We had candidates. We even had the delegates, and the day was there, and we thought we had security. We saw policemen all over. We saw our gentlemen also providing security, and at the end of the day, you saw what happened. So I want to say that we just regret that it happened, and we are now investigating to know exactly who are these who did this to us.
Okay, let's talk about the security for a moment, because these now infamous men in black, many people asking, why didn't you hire a credible security firm, or for that matter have the police, who at that time were in the periphery? And these are some men, according to certain reports, who are well known within ODM circles, and then they end up being the same ones causing chaos. Was security not planned? What was the arrangement there?
We did quite elaborate preparations, and I kept confirming that we actually had sought for enough security. You saw that there was a lot of police presence, and right from the beginning it was so smooth, and we expected that there was going to be their attention, that we were going to have their attention, as well as the attention of those who had also been...
But who are these men in black?
I cannot really tell I cannot really say that these men in black were actually people that we had, because one, I want to say that I was summoned severally to the outside when I was in the arena. One, at gate 5, that some men in black had come in through by force. Then another gate facing gate 1, and then at the VIP entrance, I was also told that there were men in black that came in. So apart from the men that we had that we thought were going to be our security, we also had intruders who came in. So at the end of the day, I was not able to tell who exactly caused this chaos.
What did you hire for security?
We hired the police, and we also...
But they were at the periphery. Who was manning the doors going into the arena? Was it a company? Was it an organization?
We had both the police and the young men who had been hired by our secretariat.
And where did the young men come
from?
And
then I was wondering...
Are they from an organized group, or is it just some of us?
No, normally the secretariat hires young men within the party to also give their services.
Okay.
Yes.
John?
First of all, let me say that what happened is regrettable. On Friday, it was uncivilized, to say the least. And you'd think that that was not actually engineered by someone meaningful for the party. Regarding what you asked, I would just say at this moment that it would be speculative to say who was responsible or who the black men were. Actually, if you listened to the speech which came from the party, through the party leader, he did mention that that is going to be one of the first assignments that the party is going to undertake, to ensure that we carry out a thorough investigation to find out who these people were, what was their motive, and who sent them. Because I don't think it was right. It was very costly for the party, and by extension the country, because as you are aware, currently political parties are funded from taxpayers' money.
And so they would require an explanation.
The Kenyan public, and more importantly, the membership of ODM is waiting for answers as to who could have done are such a barbaric.
Ngunjiri, you had predicted this months ago in articles and tweets. How do you feel about these events now? Are you satisfied with some of the explanations you're hearing here regarding security and preparations and arrangement? Many saying that this was the plan all along.
First, it's I don't actually know how to feel about this, because my predictions were not meant to prophesy that was going to happen. My predictions were more of advice, suggesting, please, let's make sure this doesn't happen. Let's watch out for this. Now, when I believe what Bandi and Judy are saying, but I've been in ODM. I've been part of the campaign. You do not walk into ODM and spoil an ODM faction unless you belong into it. You will get hurt. Somebody was making fun and saying it's like going to a Gor Mahia match and then going to throw stones in a Gor Mahia match or going to try and destroy a Gor Mahia match. ODM has people who own it, and they take ownership of the party very seriously. Those men in black are part and parcel of the ODM structure. Now, at what point they were mobilized, at what point, whatever the target was, whatever the focus of the activities was that day, is what disappoints me, because it was choreographed. I mean, at a certain point, you watch them walk in, and they didn't go to beat people up. They went in and stopped the election,
Okay. Deliberately
stopped the election. Somebody wanted that election stopped. And for me, that is the biggest disappointment about what happened on Friday. That I believed with everything I had that Friday was going to be a rejuvenation of ODM as a party.
We'll come to Sakaja in a moment, but you know, I see you want to make a response.
I just want to say that.
We
can spare Sakaja because he has also enough problems. Let me put it this way. I think what Ngunjiri said could be true. Or partly true, that you don't walk to ODM and spoil if you're not an insider. Anyone, any enemy of the party would use the same party machinery.
Okay.
That
will be a segue, because there have been the talks of outside forces and people are moles. And here we have the chair of TNA party who would be your rivals. Yes. Is Ababu Namwamba a mole of Jubilee in ODM?
Not that I know. You expect him to say yes?
You see, first of all, I must say, but I have nothing but good intentions and hopes for ODM, because I know what it means to run a party and how difficult it is to organize such things. I think, as their party leader said himself, that it was a shame. For a long time, ODM has heralded itself as the bastion of democracy and all that. At the time, an ODM member had written that the D is silent in ODM. It's just an orange movement. The democratic does not exist. But leave that alone. I've seen people on Twitter speaking about it. Somebody said that ODM cannot even win its own election.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what happened is unfortunate for all of us in political parties, because we need to be able to portray that we can accept and tolerate internal democracy in our parties. And they're going through the election now. At some point, we will be going through our election. And I think, just for the sake of democracy in this country, for the sake of political parties, which really are the home of democracy, mm-hmm. if run well,
okay.
I think it was really unfortunate. But I must also say that we had really no part to play in that. As Ngunjiri said, the execution looks very ODM. The people involved look very ODM.
What does that ODM look? Tell us. When you say they look very ODM,
I don't want, to hit ODM, because I think they're doing it themselves, and I don't want to interrupt. But the point is, for a long time, the kind of violence you're seeing there, really, within a political organization, an institution, has not been seen in many other parties. And we've seen it also in the nominations on the ground before, in Nyanza. What I'm saying is that whatever the case was, whichever camp it was that tried to do that, or whoever tried to do it, even if it was external, they should not have allowed it. And they should be able to allow and tolerate, you know, democracy to thrive within a political party.
Let's talk about your own party for a moment. And there were issues, though we know you had a retreat and things seemed to be going on well, but there was also allegations within your party of both you and the Secretary General perhaps not being duly elected. And here's why. Many people will say we saw President Uhuru Kenyatta launching TNA, and then we see Johnson Sakaja as the chair, Onyango Olo as the Secretary General, and so on and so on. And then after that, we now see you going on a member recruitment drive. Then people ask, so this is a party, didn't have members, here are the officials. Were you elected? Were you not? And Moses Akuda, it took Moses Akuda to say something for then us to see, okay, we're having a grassroots election and a recruitment drive. Aren't you in the same position now?
Let me say this. First of all, TNA has registered members across the country. If you check with the Registrar of Political Parties, it actually has the most number of members in the entire country. The party was not formed in 2012, as it were. TNA was originally NAPK, that was started in 2001. Our previous chairman, my predecessor, was one Ginyo Kariuki, who was there. We got into the party as a group of many, you know, young people and people who had a certain vision of how our politics needs to be. If you look at the records within the Registrar of Political Parties, because there were certain things that parties had to be able to ascribe to be registered again. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you all remember that. Mm. We actually had an election of NAPK before it became TNA in 2012 in April in Nairobi. I think at that time we could not attract the kind of media coverage that the big parties attract before Uhuru Kenyatta became our presidential candidate. Uh-huh. According to the constitution, we actually have a term of office. We've had members saying that they'd like, actually very few, mm-hmm. saying that they think that we need to go to an election. And I've said many times, I'm ready for an election,
right.
Even tomorrow.
To cut you short for just a moment, it's also talking about grassroots, yes. And structures, and structures that do not seem to be there for TNA. And we have a clip, I hope we can just play it in a moment, that just talks about the fact that there are no structures within TNA.
There's no party that can be registered without structures. If a member says it, maybe he does not know the structures.
All right.
Because for Uhuru Kenyatta to be nominated to be the presidential candidate of TNA, it had to have delegates.
So you
for
have
a party to be registered, for a party to be registered, actually, in the last regional parties, it had to have at least 25 offices in at least 25 counties across the country, which of course we surpassed that. But they're saying, look, they need the structures really to be activated. You know, all political parties, after
so
the election.
So the structures exist?
There are structures.
So
we
why then will you
the
be
structures.
Going into a grassroots election?
Because, not election, registration, first of all.
Yes,
because
this month.
Grassroots election, registration of members is a continuous process.
That's right.
To strengthen our political parties. Uh-huh. Elections are not held when one feels like they want to hold an election. The reason ODM is holding an election now is because their constitution states so. Their mm-hmm. office bearers mm-hmm. have a term of office. And our grassroots office bearers actually have a term of office. So at some point we have to do those elections according to our party constitution.
Okay, let's listen to Moses Kuria, who's a strategist within the party, on what he had to say grassroots.
I am the chairman of TNA. I have not appointed any strategist.
So you
party.
Do not recognize Moses Kuria as a strategist
within
TNA?
I recognize him
TNA?
As a member of the party,
okay.
A very active
all
and
right.
Resourceful person,
uh-huh.
But he has no official title in the party.
Okay,
yes.
But he does contribute strategy from time to time?
All our members do.
Okay, including him.
Well,
thank you. Let's listen to the clip. Let's listen to the clip here on what he had to say about what's happening within the party. Watch this.
TNA is a party. You know, a church is known by followers. So a party is known by its members and its grassroots leaders. It is not acceptable that a party, which is now the biggest and the most popular party within this region, within the East African region, to be without grassroots leaders. You know very well, you used to hear about so-and-so of DP, so-and-so of NAC. Have you ever heard of so-and-so here, of TNA? Kuna mtu ushasikia anaitwa nani kama wa TNA. It's not acceptable anymore that we can continue with a party without leaders. Do you know of any leaders here in Nyeri town or in Nyeri county? So we are saying time is up for games. We want to have elections all the way from the grassroots, and so that the party can have its owners. We cannot continue owning the party from Nairobi.
Right, and on that clip then, of course, talking about how power within TNA seems to be centered in Nairobi. What do you have to say?
Let me say, first of all, I think most of the sentiments aired there are really, let me not say an insult, but for our people on the ground, our leaders and our officials, really it's not a positive comment, because they actually do exist and they're there. And for you to say that you've not had Kamau at TNA and whatnot, really there must be certain different motivation. Yes, I must admit that there's a lot more work we want to do.
Uh-huh.
We have very few, we don't know the kind of presence we want to have in Nyanza province. We want to increase it in Western. Okay. And certain areas that didn't, you know, that we didn't get the kind of work that we expected. But it is a party that is founded on its membership. It has members all over the country.
Okay.
We are going to do to reactivate our structures at the county grassroots level, starting from April.
Buddy?
TNA could be having members, because I know at one point we parties were to recruit members
mm-hmm.
all over the country, and it was a requirement by Political Parties Act. But to say that TNA has officials and structures up to the grassroots, mm-hmm. I think unless they inherited from other political parties, which happens
you can
quite often in Kenya.
But it's illegal.
I tend to think that probably they inherited maybe KANU officials, because if you said TNA is NPK, I would put it that TNA is actually KANU, because we know the owner of KANU after President Moi left was Uhuru Kenyatta, who was the chair.
Then
and
in that
once he left, he must have gone with most of the officials of KANU to TNA. So TNA could be having officials who are inherited, because I can't remember any single day
mm-hmm.
that I had that TNA was carrying out an election, grassroots election, leading to election of national officials.
And I think probably at that time you must have been very busy trying to secure a nomination in ODM, and we know how democratic that process was. But the point I'm saying is this: our party actually has officials, but time has come for us to do new elections.
So when was the election?
So when did the elections happen for the grassroots?
When, around what time? I could have been busy.
It happened as NPK around 2010. That's why the term is actually ending
but
in 2014.
2010, I wasn't busy with the ODM nomination.
No, you're trying to figure out.
Even Mheshimiwa hasn't had the Bonyango of TNA in Suba.
That's basically what he's trying to say.
Before you end on this, because I'm surrounded by ODM members, the success of a political party, yeah, is not measured on how many times it does its elections or whatever you saw in Kasarani.
Uh-huh.
The success of a political vehicle and machine is how it is able to mobilize itself to acquire power, to win an election.
Okay.
We have done that once before.
Uh-huh.
ODM has never won an election, and I don't know whether that is the yardstick through which we need to measure it. And my first strategy since I became chairman of the party was to ensure we win the elections, which we did. The second strategy is to institutionalize a political movement where our members can feel that they're actually members for a certain reason.
Okay.
And that's what we're doing. And we will keep teaching ODM how these things are done.
All right. Okay. Let's talk to Judith for a moment, because and as we remember, ODM was very critical of the IEBC after the last election, claiming that they were incompetent and were unable to run that. Some would say you've lost the moral authority with the IEBC conducting elections for millions of Kenyans and you unable to manage a situation for just over 2,000 delegates. Do you now believe ODM can stand and say the IEBC failed when ODM itself was not able to conduct an election?
Well, yes. I mean, IEBC is a body that has been there and should carry out its mandate, whether we be there or not. They should be able to do, and they are accountable to do what they're supposed to do. And I want to say that ODM could have suffered on Friday, but that does not mean that we are really down, that we cannot hold an election. I still believe, and even this today I said, that we are waiting for the National Governing Council to give us a directive, and we are still ready to conduct an election. Let me say that we didn't just start the elections the other day. You know very well that in our system, the ODM has been able to carry out entire grassroots elections.
Which is probably why people expected a little bit more of this one, because it's something you've done for a while.
We have done before. We have done our grassroots. We did right from sub-location to location to ward to constituency to county. We have branch officials in all these counties and all these areas. And then we also have even done the women league elections. We have done the youth league elections up to national. It is only in the mainstream that now we have not been able to conclude.
And that is a good defense. Yes. However, if this was happening with the IEBC, who would say we've conducted by-elections before, we've conducted an election before, but here we have failed, is that an argument you'd be willing to take?
I am not even saying we have failed. This was just some sort of temptation that we really need to know what happened.
So but you don't think you failed?
We cannot really say that it is completely failed.
But
that
you didn't conduct an election, honestly. Yes.
Judas, rescue a bit. Let me put it this way. Fact. The election on Friday didn't take off as expected.
That is a fact.
That is a failure.
And that is a failure.
Didn't take off at all.
Thank you.
But no, not that election didn't take
voting
off.
Voting had started briefly. If you can count that as a success.
If you follow
the election,
because
election
is only as good as the results. That's right,
yeah,
yes.
You see, the board did so well in terms of preparation.
Really?
I was surprised to see that we had ballot papers printed properly, like. It would be.
But then there were other papers that were sneaked in.
I think people have not understood what that paper contained. That paper was a paper from candidates who were campaigning.
And they were being allowed to campaign before the election?
Just listen, Yvonne, you know what happened? Some one side of, or one team had listed those they wanted to occupy some positions.
Okay.
They could have carried the papers in their pockets, and which I think they did.
Right.
So that you can't blame on the board.
Here's the thing. Should they be carrying such paraphernalia into the election arena just before the election? And shouldn't that be the work of the National Election Board?
The moment the board got to know it, then the board needs to act. But you can also not say that the board has not acted, because that was reported to the board and immediately chaos broke out. So let us not blame the board on that.
So the board was not given enough time to act?
And I want to also put it that the board, this board that is chaired by Judy, was constituted just a few months ago, I think, You remember the chair was Franklin Met. So insofar as preparing for the day, they did well.
But I must interject to that one, because like she said, you've been conducting elections for a very long time.
No, the structures should be in place.
Would it be fair to say that...
Let me tell you that's wrong. And again, I don't want to... ODM has never had any successful election. Look at even the nominations in 2013. The sham in nominations in this country was only by ODM. The only party that actually did a credible nomination for candidates was TNA. You've never had
because
anybody,
it was not there.
Listen, you've never had anybody saying that during the nomination I won and my certificate was taken away. We saw what happened with Uhuru and NCIA with Oval, and you all know the truth. So this was actually going to be the first time they actually do a credible process. Now, if you want to tell me that Isaac, my friend Isaac Mora, we all know him in Parliament, Mbadi, we sit with him, nominated MP, representing people with disability, stopped the ODM election on Friday, really. That is.
I want to correct this misrepresentation.
Uh-huh.
That ODM has not conducted any successful election. That is not correct.
Which one?
Remember, in 2007, we went to Kasarani. Raila Odinga was nominated after beating.
You said
ODM has never conducted an election, a successful election. That is not correct.
Okay. All right.
Raila Odinga won. If it was followed by Mudavadi, number three was William Ruto, and we know it. It's only Malala who stepped down. The rest participated in election.
Okay.
So that is not accurate.
All right.
Congratulations. I was going to point out that
ODM has actually had successful elections.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I was also going to correct my good friend here. Uh-huh. That TNA, he's saying that TNA has never had issues of certificates. Mm. And we all remember there were Moi, Mishuki issue where both people were claiming they had the certificates. They've had issues.
Not at the scale and magnitude.
Of course.
But you have had issues.
But also,
actually,
we need to accept
the person who won the patent. The patent for rigging elections really is ODM.
No, they cannot stand. No, for rigging.
Don't defend them because I won't let you get away with that. If you look at, let me explain to you. Look at facts. Go look at the political party disputes, the digest, which was released 2 weeks ago. three quarters of that book is about ODM nominations in the in
yeah, because
the
it is
a vibrant party.
It is a party that
we
did
do nominations.
If, I had a candidate.
If being vibrant means rigging your candidates, I know that you're
really this is
vibrant.
I need to make a point.
Yes,
I need to make a point. First and foremost, ODM failed.
And as you speak, can you say that ODM has consistently held free and fair nominations?
No, it hasn't. Yes. I mean, that I have to also.
I mean, that'd be good.
However,
be honest.
I need to make a point. ODM set a standard. ODM has set a standard in this country as far as political space is concerned. And that's the reason that what happened on Friday is such a disappointment.
Okay.
It is not the kind of thing that we'd expect. We'd expect it with young parties, like, you know, TNA and other parties. We don't expect it with a party that
right.
is nearly
and,
10 years
and,
old.
And
that is the reason.
And that is the reason
yes.
why we
yes,
are all
that,
disappointed.
That everybody
yes.
is disappointed.
Yes.
No, but
including members.
But
including members from other parties.
Additionally, no, we're actually quite disappointed.
Yeah.
Because for real, we have been waiting to see a vibrant opposition. Badi struggles alone on the floor. There is no, you know, policy. There is no,
okay.
you know, interventions
okay.
that don't do nyumba kumi, do nyumba tatu. We saw even on Friday, them just opposing for the sake of opposing and saying things should not be done. But we want to see, and Kenyans need to see, an alternative. They need to see that this government, this is its economic policy, these are economic policy. And we thought that this election
yeah.
would actually invigorate the opposition to actually provide that
Sakaja means well. But not, I'm not sure.
He's killing us softly.
I know
he's killing ODM softly.
You're saying Sakaja means
well,
but
yeah,
that's what
I'm not sure.
He's killing ODM kindness.
Okay. All right,
because
here, let's go.
Remember, he may not even be the real owner of TNA as we speak.
The members
parties,
of the donors.
Yes, parties and captain clubs. I want us to conclude our discussion. Gunjiri,
yes.
You are quite upset and on Twitter have been making some statements like you might be thinking of leaving the party.
Actually, this is my last day in India. Tomorrow I'm handing in my resignation. And it doesn't really mean to mean much. I'm just one member. We got 5.3 million votes. So most probably my leaving is not going to make any difference. But it's my statement to the party that you just cannot do business like this. It's unacceptable for us to have seen what happened.
Which party is it joining?
We're getting there.
You know, I have to wait for 3 months before I join another party.
And which
but
party
I'm going
will
to start.
Be joining
I'm going to.
In the next 3 months?
I'm actually thinking very seriously about KANU, eh? And for
Why?
Very good reasons.
Why?
KANU is the only party we have in this country that has outlived its owners. I have looked around. I do not think ODM, after seeing what happened on Friday, I don't think ODM is going to outlive Raila Odinga.
Why not stay and fight?
Because I have tried.
Change the procedures,
I mean,
from where?
Really, Friday was where we were going to know whether the fight we've been having was going to succeed. Because on Friday, I actually expected that a team I was supporting, which I believed completely,
mm-hmm.
this is a team, this is a Babu's team. This is a team that has actually done a lot of work for ODM from 2010, including during the coalition government. I actually expected they were going to take over the party, and I had complete faith in that.
Yeah, but that sort of sounds biased, doesn't it?
It is biased.
That
yeah,
you wanted
member,
Obama to win.
Politics is biased.
But as a member, he has a vote.
Politics is biased.
Right. Okay.
So for
okay.
me, when the, if they had lost fairly, I'd have been fine. But for that drama, which, having been a member of ODM and been in the inner circle of ODM, I actually knew that was not an accident.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, that's when I was like, you know what? This party has its owners. Me, I'm walking. So I'm waiting for Monday, which is tomorrow, which was the next official working day. I give in my resignation. Now start shopping for a party.
Johnson,
is my first stop.
Are you going to be perhaps inviting him? And even as you close,
actually, I think I'm going to be inviting him. The kind of problems he's been having, I have a feeling.
Oh, you want to invite him into Kanu?
The kind of problems he's been having in TNA, he might actually be one of the guys.
Let me say this. I think Munjiri left ODM a long time ago. He's just looked for a situation to make it poetic.
That's
his
true.
Departure. And she's confirming, I don't
that's
know. But I mean, just judging by his articles and all that.
I have been challenging
yes,
the party.
In TNA, I don't think I'm facing problems because it has never been about me or my officials. It's about a clamor for certain things to be done. I am ready. I am confident that the members of TNA who know what real success of a party is, when the time comes, I will present myself to the members and I'm sure I will get elected.
In just about 30 seconds, what lessons has TNA learned from the ODM debacle?
What lessons have we learned?
Yeah.
I think when you want to learn, you aspire to somebody greater or somebody who actually can give you examples. Unless I go look at the video, really. But the point is this. Our country needs strong political parties, definitely. I think we need more Kenyans to become members of political parties.
Okay.
Because that is when we can sanitize them. When Kenyans go to the ballot, whenever an election is called, they find a list of people from which to choose from. Where does that list come from? It comes from political parties. And it's the people, the rank and file, who participate in party nominations, who are members of parties, who actually define the destiny of this country. So I think, and I hope with together with Mujiri, with Mbadi, and many other progressive Kenyans, that we can actually create a new culture of politics in our country that is, you know, centered on the people, centered on, you know, on ideology, on certain beliefs. So that when Mbadi says he's in ODM, it is not because of the part of the country it comes from. Okay. When I say I'm in TNA, it's not from the part of the country I come from.
Okay. Judith Pareno, finally, the NGC is tomorrow. Babu Namamba and his team say they are taking office. What next for ODM? Things seem a little in the air. And do we hope to have an election before the next general election within ODM?
I want to say that this afternoon, or probably just before this evening, we gave a press statement as a board. We have not declared any results. We didn't do any elections, and we also, what happened, we are sorry about it. But I want to say that there were no results declared for anybody to take up any office, and that remains our stand as a board. But I want to say that we expect that we'll still go through this as ODM. We will come maybe in a better way. We'll be able to conclude our elections. We are really deeply sorry, but I believe that we'll go through this. And I want to say again that we have done elections before as a party. We have branches, we have sub-branches, we have locations, we have a youth league up to national, we have a women league up to nationals. We achieved this through elections. We will still achieve even the mainstream nationals.
What do we expect from the NGC? Are you likely from to appoint NGC, a caretaker committee?
From the NGC, this is a national governing council. It will give directions, and we're just waiting for it tomorrow. Once they give us directions, as a board or any other organ, we'll be able to effect whatever directions they're going to give.
Okay. Yes. I'm sorry, we have very little time. If you can conclude in a minute, I'm sorry.
Okay. You just indulge me and just talk to Ngujiri.
Yes.
I'm not really saying this to persuade him to change his mind, because if he has made it, he has made it. But I will tell him that in politics, you don't run from issues. Let me just remind Ngujiri that in 2011, and Pareno knows, I was really deeply disappointed with the party elections in my constituency, because it never took off at the constituency level. But if I ran away, I would not probably be the MP today. I insisted in staying there. We had our nominations, which the first day didn't take place very well. We spoke to the National Election Board, which airlifted ballot materials. And I would tell you, I got 73% of the votes cast. Mm-hmm. And it is only my constituency, I think, in Nyanza, where no one jumped to another party who competed with me. And they all accepted defeat, and I'm the MP today. So running away is not the solution. Last statement that I wanted to make is, we need to really think seriously whether our parties are able to conduct the kind of election that we are attempting to conduct. Mm-hmm. It is not possible, like I was telling Pareno before we came in, that you are conducting an election of ODM with the delegates who were elected in 2011, in 2014, when Mudavadi was still in the party. Mm-hmm. And how sure are you that even the delegates from Rift Valley, the ones that we got, were really ODM or they moved to URP? So I think even as an issue that we need to really debate.
Okay.
Even as it goes, I just want to extend a warm welcome to the members who are disgruntled.
Of course you would do that. Of course you would do that. Gentlemen and ladies, thank you very much.
That doesn't exist.
There is no house to
thank you very much.
All our performance indicators.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have to conclude it at that point. I just want to read one last one tweet here. Sam Ohanga said, ODM needs to get rid of the old guard who still think they have rights to positions in the party. There's many more text messages and tweets that are coming in. We thank you all for being part of this and to just discuss what's happening within the various political parties. Mujiri, wish you the best in the decision that you will be making very soon. And maybe you might want to recruit some members now that this is happening, and you might want to make sure that you keep members within the party after this. That has been Checkpoint for now. I want to take another short break. We'll be right back with more, plus more of your comments on our discussion tonight. Stay with us.